A warm welcome to this special Easter edition of the programme. This is David McClelland, and we bring you this programme as a tribute to our good friend, the late James Horner, founder of Deliverance and director for many years. So sit back and relax as James Horner, through stirring narrative and music, transports us through the mists of time to answer the question, why did Jesus have to die?
The death of Jesus Christ on the cross would have been a defeat, and indeed a tragedy, if he had not risen from the dead. To get the story of Jesus into perspective is to believe that Jesus was born to die on a cross, to atone for the sins of every human soul, living or dead, in the whole world. When Jesus became aware that his hour was come to sacrifice his life for you and me, the Bible says he set his face as a flint to go to Jerusalem, for he knew that the prophet Isaiah had foretold his death when he said, "He was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities, he was brought as a lamb to the slaughter." Since the practice of sacrificing animals for the sins of humans was ordained of God through Moses, Jesus became the supreme sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. There was no more need for animal sacrifice. The religion of the Jews always believed that their God Jehovah would send a Messiah who would deliver them from the Roman occupation of their country. When Jesus of Nazareth claimed that he was their Messiah, they refused to accept him, calling him a blasphemer, the penalty for which was death. The gap widened when Jesus began to challenge their traditions, not in harmony with the God-given laws laid down by Moses. As the common people thronged to hear Jesus, the religious leaders became furious and decided that he must be killed, for all Jerusalem was filled with his doctrine. His influence in the region was becoming too powerful. Several attempts had been made to shut his mouth, without success, of course, and Jesus began to brace himself for the final showdown. Now, secret agents were mixing with the crowd, listening to Jesus and reporting everything he said to the Pharisees to give them an excuse to arrest him and bring him for trial for blasphemy. Even one of his disciples became a double agent for 30 pieces of silver. The clock of God's purposes was ticking away hours, not days, until Jesus would be arrested. His crime would be an offense of the Jewish law, not the law of God as given by Moses. His last hours before his trial found him in the Garden of Gethsemane. The dark clouds of night were closing around him. The darkness of the night gave an eerie feeling to the greater darkness descending upon his spirit. The weight of the sins of the whole world weighed heavily on his soul. 33 years ago, angels attended his birth, and a great star shone bright in the velvet black sky. But tonight, there was no welcoming star, no angels to lift his heavy load. Before leaving heaven to be born of a virgin, he knew the exact date and the time of his appointment with his Father in prayer tonight. The anguish of this hour brought pain deeper than the pain of a broken heart. He was hearing cries of the broken, held in chains of darkness. Is there no one worthy to set us free? His disciples had come with him, boosting their prowess to stand by him through the longest night. In agony of soul, he raised his tear-stained face in prayer to his Father. His prayer was so intense that beads of sweat, like great drops of blood, fell from his forehead to the ground. He cried out for his disciples, but his plea fell on deaf ears, for they had fallen asleep. He cried out again, "Can you not watch with me even for 1 hour?" The cold intensified as he knelt upon the damp grass, and his body trembled as he drew his robe around him to protect him from the cold. As the long night wore on, he became conscious of his mission to die for every sinner in the world, for he was taking their place. The voice of every blasphemer condemned him. The guilt of every murderer pressed upon him. The fear and anguish of every wrongdoer pounded his soul. He stood in the shoes of every liar, every brigand. He experienced the torture of hell for every man. It was as if he had been given a cup to drink, filled with every filthy sin, worse than drinking poison, laced with the smell of hell. He cried out to his Father from the deep recesses of his soul, "Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, let thy will be done, not mine." His legs became weak and he collapsed to the ground. Like lightning, an angel was beside him, strengthening him for the battle ahead. As the earth turned on its axis, it was the darkest hour before the dawn. His disciples were waking slowly from a fitful sleep, shivering, yawning, and rubbing their eyes with their hands, and ashamed of their lack of strength to face the last hours of the life of their leader. They had failed him when he needed them most. Across the valley, a group of soldiers and elders from the Jewish temple made ready to follow Judas, the disloyal disciple of Jesus, in an act of betrayal to arrest his master for a crime he had never committed. Judas led the way, his eyes filled with intrepidation, glancing from side to side, staring at the ground as he hurried along. He was about to betray the greatest friend he ever had. His face was flushed and cold sweat dampened his brow. Here he was with a group of brutal soldiers who would slice his head off with a sword if he changed his mind and decided to make a run for it. The darkest hour was beginning to lift. The dawn would soon be upon them, and they quickened their pace to Gethsemane's garden. Through the ghostly trees, they peered into the shadows. Judas, prodded by the soldiers from behind, tripped over a fallen branch and plunged into a little clearing, followed by the soldiers. Stopping short, they lifted their lanterns above their heads to reveal the tear-stained face of Jesus the Christ. Rushing forward, Judas planted the cruel kiss of betrayal on the brow of his master. His love of money had brought him to this hour, and now he hated himself and made up his mind to end his own life when it was all over. The next moment, Jesus was being dragged to his feet by the rough hands of his captors. Weary in body and soul, after the long night of vigil, in a lonely garden, the Son of God was bound in fetters and brought before Pilate, the Roman governor of Jerusalem, to answer charges brought against him by false witnesses for breaking the Jewish laws. Jesus stood in majestic silence, giving no answer to his accusers. Pilate was amazed by his composure as his screaming accusers lashed out at him with their lying tongues. Pilate knew Jesus was not guilty. He was in a serious dilemma. On the one hand, he wanted to set Jesus free. On the other hand, he was afraid to displease the Jews. Thinking hard, he saw a way out of his dilemma. He used an age-long custom of releasing a notable prisoner each year chosen by the people. So he gave them their choice, so that they would make the decision, not him. It had to be Jesus or Barabbas, a thieving brigand who was on death row for his crimes. The chief priests and elders of the Jewish religion feared Jesus more than any man, for he challenged the validity of their laws against the laws of God, which they had changed. So the religious leaders urged the crowd to vote for Barabbas and crucify Jesus in his place. Yet Jesus was willing to die for Barabbas and forgive all his sins. Even Pilate took a basin of water and, washing his hands, said, "I am innocent of the blood of this just man." You have made the decision. Under Roman law, he delivered Jesus into the hands of the soldiers for scourging in the common hall. Jesus, by this time, was feeling the stress of the anxious night without sleep or food, and the rude awakening by a cruel band of soldiers armed with swords and clubs. Now forsaken by his disciples, ready to be scourged, the most hideous practice of Roman law. Now, he was being rough-handled by men who showed no mercy, bent on the pleasure of whipping him until his back was torn in shreds of flesh, hanging loose, bleeding profusely. In custom, each soldier in turn boasted of their skill to inflict the greatest damage to the body of their victim, while hundreds of blood-crazed spectators cheered the competitors as each fought to be the winner. Jesus was then stripped naked before the vicious crowd, who screamed every filthy obscenity devised by the demons of hell. Cries of "Make him a king! Make him a king!" came from the crazed spectators. His nakedness was covered by a scarlet robe, put on him as a mockery. The robe began to change color as the blood from his back oozed through the fabric. This truly was the Lamb of God. Cheers filled the common hall as a soldier appeared, holding a crown of sharp 1-inch long thorns. He was shouting, "Let's make him a king! Let's make him a king!" as the soldier approached the lonely, friendless figure of Jesus standing in his own blood and holding the crown aloft. The roar of the crowd rose to deafening proportions. The gory scene continued as the sharpness of the cruel thorns pierced his head under the pressure of the hands of a heavy soldier. Spurts of red blood began to run down the face of the Lamb of God. The suffering of Jesus had hardly begun in comparison to his suffering yet to come by crucifixion. Scene 3 had closed on the drama of the common hall.
It is well.
The crowd were elbowing their way out, pushing and shoving to get a closer view of the horror of the blood-stained finger of a man, marred more than any other man. Slowly, Jesus appeared, framed by the exit door of the common hall. His back was bent, his shoulders stooped as he shuffled and stumbled into the cobbled street, leaving behind a trail of blood. Wearing his crown of thorns, he looked every inch a king. Two soldiers were outside, holding a heavy wooden cross, ready to harness it to their victim. As their rough hands grabbed him by the arms, he winced with pain, and with pleading eyes appealing for mercy, this brave victim, with all the strength he could muster, staggered onto the weight of the cross. With faltering steps and trembling limbs, Jesus the Christ began the journey to Calvary, the place of execution by the slowest torture in the world. The voices of the cursing Roman soldiers could be heard, prodding him to go on. Now he was breathing more rapidly. His heart was pounding in his breast as he struggled onto the laden cross. His parched lips were moving in silent prayer. Oh Father, help me carry this cross. The heavens were silent. The redemption of the world depended on this lonely, bleeding figure. His will to carry his cross all the way was stronger than his broken body could take. Staggering from side to side, breathing so fast, his lungs about to burst, he collapsed in the dust, pinned onto the heavy wooden cross, unable to take another step. Immediately, the Roman soldiers pulled a man out of the crowd to carry the cross up the hill of Calvary. Jesus then was half dragged and half walked between two soldiers to the hill of crucifixion, where a deep hole had been dug to take the vertical post of the cross. There they nailed Jesus to his cross, through his hands and through his feet. It is not hard to imagine the pain he suffered with every blow of the hammer. The cross and his victim was then lifted and rammed down into the hole with a thud. The body of our loving Lord Jesus convulsed into nerve-shattering tremors, there to hang until consumed by death. What a sight to behold! His face swollen beyond recognition, his back lacerated to shreds, hands torn and bleeding as the outward swing of his body bore downward, and his total weight pressing on his broken feet. Why had this to happen? Simply because he died for our sins according to the scripture. The hours of his suffering were slowly passing. The crowd had melted away, and the lonely hill of Calvary was silent and deserted, except for a couple of soldiers, a few friends of Jesus, and his sorrowful little mother, keeping her lonely vigil, protected by John the disciple. The atmosphere was somber. The silhouetted figure of a cross and its victim formed the sharp relief against the western sky. All movement on the cross had slowed to a halt. The earth below had changed color from crimson red to brown. A cold, chilling breeze was beginning to blow, swirling up the dust made by the many feet that passed that way today. A poor little mother was sitting now on a rock nearby, her head buried in her hands, covered in a black robe, weeping silently. Her mind flashed back in memory to a night long, long ago, when a little pregnant girl could find no place to have her baby and ended up in a cattle shed. She could still smell the sweetness of the hay where her baby lay. She was not much more than a teenager then. Yes, she remembered the great angel. He said his name was Gabriel. I wonder where he is now, she thought. It all seemed like a dream. She always knew it would end like this. Why could my best son not just have been like the others? Oh God, help me to understand your ways, she said. Waking from her dreaming, darkness was falling fast. This she could not understand. Day had turned to night. The Son of God was about to die. It seemed ages before death finally came. After hours of silent suffering, a cry from the cross was heard. It was Jesus asking for a drink. He was saying, "I thirst, I thirst." A sponge of vinegar was pressed to his lips. Then, in a cry that echoed to heaven, Jesus said in a loud voice, "My God,
My God, why have you forsaken me?
Then, of his own free will, Jesus bowed his head and gave his life and died.
Well, as we leave the Easter story behind and that song by Sandy Patty, I'd just like to ask you the question. Has there been a point in your life when you have met the Lord Jesus Christ face to face? Please write if you have any further questions or concerns through what you've heard in this edition of the programme. At this point, all that remains for me to do is to thank you for joining us for our special Easter broadcast. Don't forget, you can have a copy of this or any other edition of Deliverance free of charge on CD or tape just by writing to us. Just have pen and paper ready now, because here is that address. It's Deliverance, P.O. Box 34, Ballymoney, BT 53 7YB, Northern Ireland. That's Deliverance, P.O. Box 34, Ballymoney, BT 53 7YB, Northern Ireland. Our address for your emails is letters@deliverancebroadcasting.org. That's letters@deliverancebroadcasting, all one word, .org. And so from myself, David McClelland, on behalf of Wilbur Fitzgerald and all my friends in the studio team, have a blessed and peaceful end to your day and a relaxing time over the holiday season. Until we meet again, God bless you all. Goodbye.